in this effort on the Common Sense Club and Exciting Show. Amy Cook joins us on the program today. Amy, how are you doing?
Well, I'm good, Scott. How are you doing, sir? Thanks for having me on.
Glad you could join us today and appreciate your good work for the center and the defense of common sense. I mean, really, that's what it is. I think you go through the fundamentals of this and most people really understand what's going on. I know there were talks today. Give us an update on what happened. Any progress?
Well, the governor actually came to us with a proposal, and it's much the same. He actually gave us two options. One is the top-tier income tax that he's been talking about all along, so, and obviously that we've been rejecting all along. But second option, I came up with a different tax today, and that is on cigarettes. So he's got a tax of $1 a pack additional on cigarettes combined with some school shifts and some surcharges and then some tax reform. So I guess the biggest bottom line on it, Scott, is, I mean, we can have discussions all day about who's getting taxed and how much they're being taxed, and of course, it runs the gamut with the governor here now. But the point is, he's still looking for about an additional $1.4 billion in spending. And when you look at the Republican budget that we passed, it was the largest general fund budget in the state history. For a bunch of Republicans that came here wanting to reduce the size of government, that was a hard pill to swallow. That was a budget that, you know, we put forward in good faith because we knew we had a governor that wanted to spend more. We wanted to spend less. You know, we came in with what we felt was, a more than reasonable budget. And so it's just, you know, for the governor to come back looking for an additional almost $1.5 billion in spending, it's just a non-starter for us.
And, of course, higher taxes that I don't know how many times you said over and over and over again, that will make the problem worse, but that doesn't seem to be sitting in with the governor, that the line has been drawn. This is a spending problem, not a revenue problem, and it's like the Groundhog Day movie. Just keep doing the same thing over and over again, and, what's it going to take, do you believe, the senator to ultimately have them realize that you've drawn a hard, fast line in the sand here and are not going to budge on it?
Yeah, and, you know, if taxes were the answer, Minnesota wouldn't have a budget problem. We've got the sixth highest corporate income tax in the country, one of the highest death tax rates. We're overall, according to Tax Foundation, the seventh highest taxed state in the nation. And yet, we have, these continued budget forecast issues. And so the answer isn't more taxes. We've got lots of taxes already in the state. We need to look at how we're spending, what we're spending money on, and it's not just about just, making the deep cuts. It's about reforming the way we're spending and spending in a different way, in a way that's sustainable. That's really the discussion. This budget that we passed is about a 6% increase in spending, and still that's not enough. So the governor is looking for double-digit growth in state spending in a year when most families and most businesses have seen a reduction in their income, or at least staying the same, and oftentimes a reduction.
Well, 6 days in, and the more request for more tax revenue and more spending would lead you to assess the situation if you're not making progress. Are you not?
Well, when you can drill into the bills, we are, Scott. And you mentioned a temporary funding bill. We could pass a temporary funding bill tomorrow, and the shutdown would end. We could continue discussing. We have got, it's not one big budget bill. We've got nine different budget bills. And on six of the nine budget bills, we are incredibly close to agreement with the governor. He's put out some data today that shows we're a little further apart than we actually are. The facts are there's little to no gap in six of the nine budget areas under discussion. So that leaves three final areas, and they are the ones that surprise no one. There's a tax area, obviously. There is the state government, and we would argue that, we need to get a handle on what we're paying in benefits and wages. Just as the private sector has to done, state government needs to get that more in line and more reasonable. And then thirdly, it's the health and human services, which is your Medicare, your Medicaid matches, it's your welfare benefits. It's the area of the budget that is growing so fast, double digits, every 2 years, and we have to get a handle on it. The federal government and their health care is driving the cost to the state. We have to separate ourselves from that. We have to reform what we're doing there because the Republican budget has a $600 million increase in this area of the budget. $600 million from last year. And again, it's still not enough. So there's clearly a spending problem, and that area of the budget is the worst. But six of the nine budget bills could be, you know, wrapped up by Friday.
So, to the tax area, state government spending, what was the third item, by the way, on the three of the nine that you still put at the bottom?
Yeah, it's state government spending, it's health and human services, and then it's the tax bill, obviously, which includes some money to local governments. And then different areas of taxation.
By the way,
and obviously the governor wants to see a large tax increase.
Whose fault is it? What remains a fair expenditure? The time set down, and what isn't? I know some folks have been reading really upset that the prisons get cable, but restaurants close. I mean, who makes the decision that we're going to still pay for cable, but we're going to close restaurants?
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah, no, it has been really random. I mean, it's gone to a special master now through the court. And it is interesting. I mean, restaurants are closed, but the zoo is open. And this is why it's not meant for the courts to decide. This belongs with the legislature and the executive branch, the governor. We should get this resolved. We could resolve it, but all of this special master, all of these essential service discussions, none of that is necessary. We could pass a temporary funding bill tomorrow, and everyone could be funded at some level, keep government going, resolve the issues on these bills, or conversely, you could pass the six bills where we're closed, and then pass temporary funding for the final three and resolve those issues. But the discussions are essential, and the court making those decisions, none of that's necessary. The shutdown's not necessary. But what we do need is the governor needs to call us back. That is one thing. The legislature, I cannot call back the state Senate. Speaker Dillard cannot call back the state House. We cannot do that. By Constitution, we had to adjourn at the end of May, and only the governor now can call us back for a special session.
By the way, Walter Mondale weighed on this for saying the problem is that you're having to clean up Tim Pawlenty's mess. How do you respond to that?
Well, I appreciate folks that want to come in with constructive suggestions. Ultimately, the negotiation is between the governor, the speaker, myself, and our caucuses and the people we represent. I don't think it's helpful to be pointing fingers and blaming. I could do that. The Minnesota Senate has been in DFL control for the last 38 years, and I'm 39 years old, so I could place the blame there if I wanted to. I don't think it's helpful. It's not helpful. Let's just, take the budget as it is. Let's live within our means. Let's tighten our belt. Let's do the same thing that Minnesota families have been doing for the last 3 or 4 years. State government should be no different.
And by the way, Mondale and Arne Carlson, former Republican governor, have come together to put forward a plan. Is there anything in that that could break this logjam or anything of merit that you see in what they propose?
I'll be happy to look at their proposal. I would have been happy to sit down with them prior to this. But if it's going to be tax increases, which I suspect that's likely, then it's not about how much more money we need. It's about how we're spending that money. And so, if they can come with some really great spending reductions and reforms, something that looks fiscally responsible, I'm absolutely open to suggestions. I'm happy to have them.
Give me a prediction. How much longer is this shutdown going to have to go before you break through here, get a sense of no means no to what you've been saying 10 weeks, 6 weeks before the session, right through the first 6 days of this stalemate?
Right. Well, we've been clear from the beginning. We passed the balanced budget back in May. We've offered three or four different compromises to the governor in June. We asked him to do a lights-on bill at the very end to avoid all of this. Ultimately, now it is in the hands of the governor's staff, and so it's impossible for me to predict that. Again, my members will come back tomorrow, pass the lights-on bill, and continue these discussions. But ultimately, that is up to the governor's side.
Final question for you. Governor Dayton seemed critical of the fact that this was a political fundraising opportunity for the GOP, which, by the way, I don't know, all sides, and I don't know that using this, but I mean, clearly what the Democrats have done all along here is play the shutdown and hope to a politically boomerang, and somehow that's okay. But evidently they have some concerns about this being a fundraising opportunity for the GOP in Minnesota. Was he right to criticize that?
Well, I think the DSL is using it as well. I don't look at that. What I'm more concerned about, Scott, is using, I think the Pioneer Press accused the governor of political hostage-taking with these bills. As I said, there are 6 of the 9 that could be wrapped up quickly. So why wouldn't we do that? I think that's more of a concern to the people of Minnesota. If we are so close on more than half of this budget, 6 big bills, and it's law enforcement, it's courts, it's roads, it's schools, it's colleges, all of these areas of budget to be wrapped up quickly, and they're not. And I think that's a better question for the governor to focus on, is why wouldn't we do those bills, get them out of the way, and then continue some temporary funding for the bills that need more work, which are the Health and Human Services and state gov. That's I think, a more important question about, than the fundraising question.
Appreciate the update and the first-hand information on the meeting today. Thanks so much, Governor. Good to talk to you.
It's always good to talk to you, Scott. Have a wonderful day, sir.
Not much in the way of progress there as this continues. You know, I don't necessarily think that's a bad thing. It's ultimately an important message to be sent here, and folks say, hey, enough is enough. We said it's not a tax problem. It's not more revenue. It's spending. So keep battling. Appreciate the update. We'll continue more on the 7 Show, the Common Sense Market.